Hello, and we are here at the Rock Bowl. Had some technical difficulties starting off, but we pick up action with the Duhawks winning the toss, and they elected to receive the ball as the Duhawks are on their own 35-yard line. England hands off to Bausch, and Bausch is going nowhere. Stopped by the co-defender in the backfield, nowhere to go.
Yeah, Ty had a nice first carry to pick up the first down there on the second play of the game, and that time no dice.
Something the Duhawks are going to get. Ty is somebody the Duhawks are going to want to get going early here, EJ. And how do you suspect them to do that?
Well, he's very versatile. They can give him the ball in space through handing it off or throwing it to him in the flat. Let's throw a play action there. Almost picked off. It looked like it was tipped.
Yeah. As EJ said, England's pass attempt was batted down by the co-defense. And who's somebody the Lord's going to want to watch out for today?
Number nine for the Cohawks, I believe. His name is Alex Aitchison. 5.5 sacks this year. I believe that is good for second in the conference. We know Loris has had a history of O-line struggles. Been a lot better this year compared to years past, though.
Like EJ said, number nine, Alex Aitchison. Going to keep your eye out for him. England and Bausch. Pistol formation in the backfield. Quick drop back from England. Looking to throw it deep to his man. He's got him, and he's overshot. I believe that is Michael Crawford.
Yeah, just missed right there. Had him. Just off his fingertips, it appeared.
Duhawks looking to take a shot early here against the Cohawks, maybe catch him off guard. And like we said, that toss just a little out of the fingertip reach of Michael Crawford.
I think Crawford's going to find himself in the end zone today. He hasn't found himself in the end zone yet this year. I think he's due.
And that would be a huge help for the Duhawks, as this on paper looks like it should be a fairly close game.
Yep. Two of the better teams in this conference.
Driscoll, the punter here for the Duhawks. Gets it away, and it's not a bad one as the Cohawks are going to fair catch this one right around the 37-yard line.
Yeah, Coe has a pretty good ground game, averaging just under 200 yards on the ground this year, just over 200 in the passing. So Loris definitely has the advantage in the passing by like 90 yards a game, but they do have the disadvantage in rushing by like 30 yards a game.
So how big of an impact will that front of the Duhawk line play today?
It's going to be huge. You're going to have to stop the run. That's what Coe likes to establish, the run. They just slow the game down, but to come out in the pass first play.
Maskey's throw is a little low to his receiver, number 19, Amel Saric, but the pass was completed anyways.
Yeah, play action. Good start to the game for the Cohawks.
Maskey in the backfield, shotgun formation. Hands off to his running back. Excuse me, and he's hit hard for a fumble! Joey Foley causing the fumble!
Wow, what a hit. He came in there, got his nose dirty, laid the boom. One of the better cornerbacks overall in conference, but probably, I would say, the best tackling cornerback in conference.
Joey Foley giving the lift to this Duhawk crowd early in the game as EJ just, wow.
Wow.
Look at that. That was number two, Trenton Barnes, the running back on the play. Looked a little shaken up after that hit, but I would be too after getting laid out by Joey Foley.
Yeah, you don't see many corners make big hits like that. Kind of looked like his brother Jack Foley last year.
England Bausch in the backfield. Britt lined up behind tackle. Bausch gets it. Not much to run, maybe around a yard there.
Big momentum boost there for the Duhawks as they start on the other side of the field.
Do you think the Duhawks will take a shot here maybe? Try and get the switch of momentum, try to take a shot early?
Yeah, the run game hasn't seemed to be too effective so far either.
Same personnel on the field for the second down. England with the quick drop back, gets to McGovern over the middle. Makes one man miss. Drove him backwards, holding on to the ball. Looks like it's going to be second and four here for the Duhawks. Third and four.
Good connection there, the McGovern. This Cohawk defense, one of the better ones. The Duhawks have faced so far this year, averaging 13 points given up a game. And I was checking the stats today. Warburg's at 5 points a game. This is an incredible defense they have.
The Duhawks took on Warburg a couple weeks ago, and they lost that one 42-3 as England. Push out of the pocket by the co-defense. Looking, fakes the defender like he's going to throw it and steps out of bounds for the first down.
Great play right there. Not trying to force anything, just picking up with your legs. Good pressure there by Aitchison. I believe that was also number 65. He's not listed on this one. Jamarcus O'Banner on the pressure there.
And how in that play, how much did we see that Evan England doesn't look like a sophomore in that play?
Yeah, that was really a lot of poise there by England. Still keep his eyes down the field when he gets out of the pocket. Nothing's there. Don't force it. Pick it up with your legs.
Bausch gets the handoff. Bouncing out to the right. Picks up a good gain of around 4 yards, but there is a flag on the play.
Good pickup there, but this might be coming back.
So we get the call from our head official.
And the Duloks are going backwards.
Holding on the offense, number 19. That's a 10-yard penalty. Repeat first down.
That one's on number 19, Zach Redinger, the sophomore tight end from Morris, Illinois.
See trips here again for the Duhawks.
And Zach Redinger, the tight end, the sophomore, has really come on this year, hasn't he, EJ?
Yeah, a lot of young tight ends on this Duhawk team. None of them had a really chance to play last year, so good opportunity for them to prove themselves this year.
Another run to Ty, who goes nowhere on that one.
Another carry for number 21, Ty Bausch. No gain on the play.
Great stop there. Quahog D-line's looked very good so far today.
Yeah, a lot of big personnel up there. It looks like they're running a 3-4, EJ. What's a 3-4 better for as compared to a 4-3 for defense?
Well, they're going to be able to stop the run a little better, and they're kind of counting on their guys to win their matchups then on the outside. Well, I wouldn't take too many risks with the dangerous receivers Loris has with McGovern and Damani Brown.
Damani Brown, top of your screen as England drops back, brush out of the pocket, throws it, and he's got Monty Brown, who catches that for a first down past the original line of scrimmage. Not a first down, excuse me. He's back to around the original line of scrimmage.
Great play right there by England. Threaded the needle right over the defender. Monty Brown able to keep both feet in. Secure the catch.
Making it a much more manageable third down here for the Duhawks as compared to third and 20.
Be interested to see if the Duhawks go for it here. They only have 2 field goals so far this year.
Monty Brown and Crawford out there, as well as Marty McGovern. England, 3-step drop back, throws it over to Crawford over the middle, who's met before the first down marker, which will bring up fourth down, and like EJ said, it'll bring up challenge time here for Coach Almaniac. See what he's going to do.
It's a great tackle right there when they're 53, John Bell.
And it looks like the offense is going to stay on the field, EJ.
Yeah, I figured this is going to happen. England's money in these short down needs to pick up the first down situations. Great at making the play, just got to give them a little time.
It's going to be fourth and third here for the Duhawks. Have 4 defensive linemen on the line. McGovern and Brown, top of your screen as you see Bosch motion out. England, quick drop back. Looking for Crawford in the end zone.
Oh.
And no good. Crawford could not come down with the ball. A little overthrown as the Duhawks turn it over on downs.
They like the one-on-one matchup there on the outside. Just couldn't connect. That's twice. Crawford appears to have his man beat by a step and just couldn't not connect.
LaDainian Liner was the cornerback in coverage there. As the Duhawk defense comes back out, as we're still waiting on the Quahog offense.
Interesting choice. He has one-on-one on the outside there. So you like your matchup, but it is fourth down. So it's interesting not trying to pick up the first down instead of going all the way. But you like your guys in their one-on-one matchups, yeah. You got to get it to them.
The Quahogs turn the ball over on their first possession of the game. Let's see how they bounce back here. And it'll be interesting to see if we see Ray Sedell here or if it's still Trenton Barnes who fumbled it. And it's not Barnes, as Maskey drops back quick and gets it out. Quick hitter there for the Quahogs.
Yeah, Liddell and Barnes, two of the better rushers in this conference, both over 300 yards so far this year.
Same personnel for the Quahogs as they're in shotgun formation. They hand this one off as he makes his cut up the field for the first down and more. As I believe Brett Bauer bombed down after the sticks.
Great cutback right there.
Jaron Sanders with the rush there for the Quahogs.
Spot up the ball approaches the 31-yard line. Result of the play is a first down for Co.
As Co's getting the play ran in here.
Co can't get away from the run here, even though they forced the fumble on the first play or first drive of the game.
Play action pass. Picked up, makes Jay Squinn miss as Gwynn is able to bring him down, though. Bringing up a second, very manageable here for the Cohawks.
Look for Mason Morris to make a lot of plays here today. Second in the conference in tackles, only behind the leader by one.
What does that show about Mason Morris? Because fans of the Duhawks know that he's not the biggest guy out there. What makes him so special out there?
He's the best, one, probably the best athlete on this team. He's super strong.
Maskey's throwing it over the middle for a man wide open. Blown coverage for the Duhawks as the Cohawks are going to run that one in for a touchdown. That was number four, Cooper Zeck, the tight end, with the touchdown.
Yeah, he just was wide open right there. He had the safety and the linebacker, Brett Bauer and Josh Kiefer, both chasing him.
And that's really nothing too special, was it? Just a seam hitter in the...
No.
Duhawks safety just weren't on the same page.
Appeared to be in, yeah, blown coverage, either by Kiefer or Bauer.
The kicker for the Cohawks today will be number 46, Julian Garcia Alale. And the long snap is going to be number 33, Stone Cummins. Snap is up. Kick is up, and that one looks like it's no good.
Wow.
So the lead remains 6-0 for the Cohawks. Is looking on their side of the field, they got a pretty big crowd over there.
Yeah, they've...
Cohawks travel well.
It's probably the biggest opposing crowd we've seen so far this year.
Shortest drive as well, though, so maybe that plays a factor into it.
Yeah. Duhawks need to get one back. They're 5-15 since 2001 against the Cohawks. See a replay here.
AJ, can you break it down for us? What happened there?
Yeah, Kiefer, from that angle, not 100% able to tell, but I'm assuming Bauer is supposed to pick up there because it's kind of deep down the field for your linebackers to be.
Because your linebackers usually, when do they stop covering tight ends or their man in zone coverage?
All depends on the type of zone, but probably, I think Kiefer is probably about to be 15, 20 yards there. And Bauer is supposed to get the deep third.
As both teams are ready for this kickoff after Co's short but long touchdown play and drive. The kick is up for the Duhawks. It looks like it's Ty Bausch going to be returning this one. Ty makes a cut to the right and is knocked down right after the 25-yard line.
I like having Ty back there. He's going to make a play one of these times. Big play coming.
Do you think the Duhawks are going to stick with the run here, UJ, or do you think they're going to start maybe mixing a few more passes?
I wouldn't be surprised if mixing some few more passes. Like the play action, keep as many defenders as you can in the box and let your guys go make a play on the outside. We've seen Crawford, said he's got beat a couple times, just a little off in the timing.
Jamal Britt, the running back in, lined up behind Evan England. As they hand it off to Britt, it looks to bounce out the outside. He's brought down right around the line of scrimmage, and once again, Duhawks having nowhere to run the ball.
Co swarming the run.
Number 13, Jaheim Haynes, has checked in for the Duhawks as well. As well as Marty McGovern and Monty Brown are the receivers. England, Britt, pistol formation. England. Quick drop back, looking to get out in the flat to his tight end, and the ball is knocked down once again, I believe.
Second pass deflection already for the Cohawks.
They'll bring up third and 9 or 10, and it's... This drive for the Ducks isn't looking overly promising so far, EJ.
Yeah. Their sideline's kind of dead, too. This whole side of the stadium's kind of dead right now. All the noise coming from the coast sideline.
England and Britt once again. England drop back. He's brought down, I believe, that's number 9, Alex Aitchison, in there for the sack for the Cohawks. As there's, honestly, there's three Cohawks there to make the sack. So it'll be interesting to see who gets the credit. Could have been as well number 42 for the Cohawks, Brady Lyons.
Yeah, not much time there for England. Try to get around, but those three co-defenders right on top of them.
And what adjustments are Coach Helminiak and offensive coordinator Olsen going to have to make fairly quickly here if they want to keep this one close?
Well, I think the O-line needs to step it up. They haven't really been able to run blocks too well so far today. Maybe some more play-action passes. Just connect on those one-on-one opportunities that they're going to get.
Driscoll's punts away, and it takes a little bit of a Duhawk bounce as that one will be downed right around the 43-yard line. Yeah, looking over at this Duhawk offense that's out there. I don't know, you see a lot of heads down a little bit. Not a lot of energy going around there. Not a lot of talking, it seems like.
Yeah, we need a big-time momentum shift right here for the Duhawks.
Maskamble got Sanders in the backfield for the Cohawks. He's going to hand it off a little bit of a high snap. He's going nowhere. Met immediately by the Duhawk defensive line. There's number 43, Andrew Hafel, in there to make the stop.
Number 25, Jaron Sanders with the carry. Tackle is made by number 43, Andrew Hafel.
Interesting, Sanders is getting the carries the last two drives. Only 18 carries before today compared to their top two running backs, 105 and 63.
So maybe a little bit of injury for the Cohawks as Maskus to get that one early, and that one going nowhere. I believe that's Brett Bauer on the coverage there, break that one up as he's looking for his tight end. Once again, Cooper Zeck.
Good coverage there. Had an opportunity to complete it. Just couldn't reel it in because Bauer is right there.
As the Dorks are going to make some substitutions here for third down, as Kiefer and Jordan check back in, as well as Sean Doyle.
Kiefer leading the team in sacks and tackles for loss. Hasn't had too big of a game any week since he won ARC Player of the Week.
Mask, third and 10, looking to pick up the first down. Overthrows his receiver. He was looking for number 15, Dominic Shepherdson, the 6-foot senior.
Yeah, he had him, just couldn't connect there. Looked like it would have been just short of the first down, though, either way.
Good stop here for the Duhawk defense, who, besides the blown coverage, has looked pretty good today.
Yeah.
It was going to be fourth and nine. As you hear people tell the Duhawks to get the ball.
Looks like they're going to send the guys after it.
Marty McGovern standing on his own 20-yard line. About to receive the punt from Chase Cruz. Punts away, and looks like that one will go out right around the 27-yard line. Oh, the official's still walking up. Going to be down right at the 30-yard line.
Good spot for the Duhawks. Good three and out right there.
That should maybe give this, not just the team, but these fans some life, hopefully, that three and out.
Yeah, very dead this week.
But we all know the real way to get the fans involved, DJ, and that's with the score.
Yeah. Empty backfield right here. Trying to spread this defense out.
Like EJ said, empty backfields. We get motion here by Bausch that now lines up, moves out to the flat. That's where they're going to give it to him on a little bit of a screen. As Bausch gives him the stiff arm and runs out of bounds.
Good pick up there.
He's brought out of bounds by number 49, Ben Reidenauer.
Pushed out of bounds at the 37, second down.
Haynes, Brown, and I believe that's Crawford at the bottom of your screen and McGovern at the top. So they give the screen to Crawford, and Haynes missed the block there, allowing Crawford to not go anywhere.
Did he pick it up? Yep, just enough.
First down here for the Duhawks as they remain in this spread five-out offense. Does that affect the pass rush that the Cohawks bring, EJ?
Yeah, having to stay on the field and just in your mind as a pass rush, you're going to be a lot more tired.
England brushed out of the pocket and wisely just throws this one away.
Good pressure once again for Aitchison.
It was a good job by England. They're not going down on the first attempt either.
Wouldn't be surprised if Bosch finally gets a carry here in this drive.
How important will it be for the Duhawks to wear out that front of the Quahawks early in this game?
It's going to be big. Co really likes to slow the game down and try to wear out the opposing defenses. So Flores needs to stay on the field, keep Co's defense on the field and their defense off.
Oh, looks like it's a late hit. Late, and that will be a late hit. Looks like it'll be on number 40, Ben Adelsberger, the junior.
Yeah, just gave him a nice shove, 1 to 3 yards out of bounds, it looked like.
And I don't know if Ty's just tired or if he's a little banged up, but he's on the sideline. Looks like he's on one knee.
Probably just needs a breather.
As Jamal Britt, Killian Pritchett has checked in for the Duhawks. KP. As it is a late hit, here on number 40, as you'll see it coming up here. And once again, just getting out to tie in the flat, and yeah, there you see, she can't do that, can you, EJ?
No, second defender came in. You see Aitchison got pancaked there on the double team. His helmet fell off. He looked like he asked the ref to throw a flag for something.
As he has to come out now because he lost his helmet for a play. And 42, Brady Lyons has checked in for him. As I believe the official is asking for a restart of the play clock there with that motion. Pritchett has checked in now for the Duhawks. So we're going to give it to him on the first play, his first play of the game. And he picks up a good gain there of 5 yards.
Yeah, great carry there.
It looks like the Duhawks are going to go a little bit of no huddle here. Try and wear out the Quahawks.
If they go fast, might be able to get 12 men.
Oh, they got him, it looked like. But
the refs did not see.
Yeah. Pritchett goes nowhere, and there's going to be a flag here, possibly a hold.
Yeah, it looked like they got him when he's still on the field there.
I'm really surprised that ref that was saw him running off didn't throw a flag there either.
Yeah.
As we got another penalty here. As we have some discussion, as you can hear somebody yelling about 12 men on the field.
That was a great countdown they got going there. 9, 10, 11, 12.
As it looks like Helminiak is saying there's 12 men on the field.
I think he was
officials.
No, I think he was laying into the lineman right there. Yeah, that's what saw a head nod come from good old Titus.
Crawford, Haynes, and Brown, the three receivers that are bunched up for the Duhawks with McGovern up top. He's gonna go screen to Monty, maybe make a guy miss. And not able to, as Jaheim Haynes once again. Just not able to block a man there.
Nope.
Which, running these screen plays, I don't know if you're going to want Jaheim out there very much after seeing these first couple screen attempts and his blocking.
Yeah. Surprised they haven't thrown more to McGovern side on these screens. He's the biggest receiver, great blocker.
So Duhawk 20 seconds on the play clock as the Duhawks still haven't got the play in yet. Killian Pritchett, still the running back, since we saw Ty get hit late out of bounds. England gets it, fakes the screen, and Alex Aitchison with the sack. The big sack.
There's no time there for England. Aitchison immediately in the backfield once again.
As that is Aitchison's 6.5 sack on the year. And he's a big guy and hard for the – it's been hard for the – Duhawk offense to block him so far this game.
Yeah, haven't had an answer for him so far.
It's fourth down, and Driscoll's away to punt again. And Shepherdson standing right around his own 17-yard line to receive this one. Just taking this down away on the play clock.
Oh,
as that punt is almost blocked and is not a good punt at all. As it looks like.
I have to wonder if maybe he got a hand on it, because that was not a good punt.
As the official is still walking. It looks like he's going to down it at the 42-yard line.
Aiden Driscoll with the punt for Loris.
Oh, the 43-yard line. Excuse me.
The 43-yard line. First down for the Cougs.
Maskey, and it looks like Barnes is back in after that fumble he had on the first drive. As they fake the handoff to him. As another blown coverage for the Dewhawks. As that is number 19, Sarich running. And a touchdown saving tackle there for the Dewhawks by number 33, Rashad Johnson.
Maskey's pass is caught by number 19, about Sarich.
Don't see Johnson out there too much.
As the Cougs going to be looking to take a 12-0 lead here as they are knocking on the Dewhawk door.
Blown coverage so far today for the Dewhawks. It's hurt them.
Barnes, a running back once again. You see Shepherdson in motion. They hand it to Barnes and just a big hole on that right side. And he's in for the touchdown, but there is a flag.
Dewhawks done a good job stopping the run so far today. Just the passing plays have hurt them.
A minute 20 left to go here in this first quarter as we get the call from our official. He's talking to Coach Greg Bauer to see what he wants. So, Trenton Barnes, after his fumble, must have been getting a little too excited with the touchdown.
Yep. Surprised Cougs aren't going for two here as they missed the first extra point. And the Dewhawk defense seemed to be very rattled after that huge gain.
Garcia Ayala to kick this one for the Cougs once again. The snap's good, holds good, kick looks pretty good as that is right down the middle.
Dewhawk offense needs to get some life going here. Keep them in this game.
13-0 here. The Cougs leading the Dewhawks. And what do the Dewhawks need to do just to get the offense moving?
They need to give England some more time. He's had no time today, really. Pressure constantly by Aitchison and the rest of the Cougs D-line. They haven't looked awful, though. There's been open receivers. They've had some good gains on the ground. And then that's the other thing. There's been some good gains on the ground, but mostly they've been able to contain Ty, KP, and JB.
Yeah, I believe just off the top of my head that the longest rush the Dewhawks have had today is like 6 yards.
Yeah, nothing cooking so far on the ground.
Or really in the air,
yeah,
as well.
Let me see if there's a design run play for England here this drive.
As the ball got knocked off the tee due to the wind. It's not a very windy day here in the Rock Bowl, but it's enough of wind to where you can feel and it could possibly play an effect into some kicks or some throws.
Absolutely.
As that kick is away, and it's going to go out of bounds for a penalty flag, I believe. Or not. Never mind. Oh, there it is. He dropped
yeah,
it.
Yeah, I was going to say.
As that ball went out of bounds at the Dewhawks 22-yard line.
The ball will be placed at the 50-yard line. First down.
It's a Ball is going to be placed at the 50-yard line if you did not hear the official.
Good starting field position here for the two Hawks. Might be the boost they need to get going. This Cohawk defense has shown why they've only been giving up 13 points a game this year.
As it looks like Johnny Kaysen has checked in as our running back, and the running back Jamal Britt cannot handle that one out in the flat.
England's pass is incomplete. Gotta secure those.
As it looks like there's a lineman down for the Dewhawks. It looks like that is
might be the left 79. Is that Housing Gay? Yeah, it looks like it is. He's had a lot of injury history in his 2 years here.
Housing Gay, the 6'4 senior out of Washington, Iowa, as you see him there.
Limping off.
Yeah. Looks like his left leg, looks like he's not really able to move it a whole bunch.
Tyson Smith's in to replace him.
Smith, the 6'4 sophomore out of Morrison, Illinois, as England and Kaysen the second in the backfield. Britt, Brown, and McGovern at the bottom of your screen. England, deep drop back, gets it to Hames over the middle and goes nowhere as there's a flag on the play.
Yep, looks like. Did he get him by the face mask or is it a horse collar?
Looks like he was tackled up top a little bit on the head. Is that flag came from the judge over the backside? It looks like it's going to be on the Dewhawks.
Oh, wow. Dewhawks just keep shooting themselves in the foot with these penalties.
It's kind of interesting to see a block in the back over a play that got maybe 2 yards away from the line of scrimmage as well.
Dewhawk fans not happy with that call.
Yeah, the Dewhawk fans starting to get a little rowdy with these refs. Feel some of the calls haven't gone the correct way.
I think that was the right call, though, on the no horse collar face mask. He just hit him up top. He didn't make an illegal tackle, though.
England and Case in the backfield. England three-step drive. Gets it to Brown over the middle for the first down. That Brown. Sophomore connection once again.
Yep, they found the soft spot in the zone between three defenders right there. Brown, sure hands, reels it in, pick us up first down.
Bringing some life to the Rock Bowl here is the Dewhawks and Starco, no huddle. England gets the snap, gets it to Kaysen out in the flat. Good blocks. Still on his feet.
Ooh.
He's brought down after a 5-yard gain. That's going to be a flag. Looks like that'll be maybe targeting as he came in with the crown of his helmet. That was number 49, Ben Reidenauer.
Johnny Kaysen getting a touch. You don't see that too often.
As I'd be wondering if they could call targeting here, if it's going to be unnecessary roughness, as I believe he came in a little late, but
yeah.
It almost looked like he did leave with that crown of his helmet.
Yeah, this one could go either
and
way.
I think that's probably what they're talking about right now. Yeah, because there's two flags on the field. As
replay.
We take a replay here, so officials are talking. And you see, you'll see 49 coming up out the middle of your screen right here. Oh, that's targeting. I believe that's what they'll be calling. Or what would you think, EJ?
Yeah.
Oh, here we get the call.
Personal foul on the defense, number 49, targeting.
Oh, yep. As that'll really get the crowd into it, a disqualification.
Yeah. Man, that rule is tough. Losing one of your players like that is always hard.
And we saw that last year for the Dewhawks, as you see 49 right there on the sideline, done for the day, as the officials will probably come up at halftime and take a look, because that's what they did last year when they called the targeting as well.
Yeah, you want to review it, make sure it's right.
But I think it is right. I don't think they'll have to really look at it for too long.
It was close, but it's hard. You need solid evidence to overturn it, and I don't think they're going to have that evidence.
England and Casey in the backfield. England pushed up in the pocket, throws it across to McGovern, and Aitchison got his big paw on that one.
Good play there by Aitchison, getting back towards the football, working his way back down the field. Good idea there by England. He could have gotten some yards off his legs, but McGovern was wide open. Yeah, just a better play there by Aitchison.
Aitchison, a pretty athletic kid out there. Listed at 6'6", 245, so athletic and a big guy out there. Who's caused havoc for the Duhawks all game. As Bonnie Brown's in motion, Duhawks going to hand this one off to Johnny Kaysen, who hits his hole and gets close to the first down.
Great run right there by Kaysen.
Going to be a yard short. Duhawks' biggest run of the game for 9 yards, bring up a 3rd and 1.
That will be the quarter.
End of the quarter here. As the Cohawks lead your Duhawks 13-0. And EJ, that first quarter, not much to talk about except for this last part here. What are you liking so far? What's going on?
Well, this last drive has given some life into the Duhawks. They've been helped by a couple penalties by the Cohawks. Less penalties for them this drive, and you can continue to stay disciplined, not pick up any more penalties. And the run game's starting to have a little life in it now, so we need to keep that going. That'll be key for this Duhawk offense that's averaging around 160 yards a game on the ground.
And how big will that targeting on the middle linebacker for the Cohawks, Ben Reinauer, especially with him being a senior, how does that affect maybe the energy that they had?
Yeah, losing a senior player always hurts, especially one of your starters. So we'll see who steps up and fills in for the Cohawks, if he can bring the same energy and juice that he was bringing.
As both teams out there and ready to get this second quarter underway. And it's 3rd down and short here for the Duhawks. On Coe's 11-yard line. Bausch checked back into the game as well as Britt. The handoff to Bausch, who was met immediately by the Cohawks. Number 45, Jay Ostendorp.
Anytime it's been an obvious run situation for the Duhawks and they have ran the ball, it has not worked out well for them.
And it looks like Duhawks are going to kick this one. Pretty smart. Just get on the board, won't you say, EJ?
Yeah, 4th and 3. Nothing cooking on the ground. They have a good pass rush. Got to end up with some points here.
With number 39, Scotty Talmadge. The sophomore out of Ankeny, Iowa, to kick this one. Looks like it'll be a 29-yarder. Kick is up. It is good. Putting the Duhawks on the board. 13-3 at the start of this second quarter.
Good guy on the board. Need another stop here. Duhawk defense just needs to communicate. Not have these blown coverages that have hurt him so badly.
And is that really the only adjustment that the defense needs to make? It's just communication? Because that's usually what blown coverage is, correct? Is communication?
Yeah. Just not knowing your assignment. We have not seen them really throw Joey Foley's way this game yet.
Yeah, as you'll remember, early on in that first quarter, Joey Foley with the big hit to give the Duhawks that early momentum, but they just weren't able to do anything with it. As Talmadge is back to kick this one away. As the ball blown over once again by the wind.
Beautiful day out today, Hugh.
It is. Sun shining, not too hot. Leaves changing colors. It's a beautiful time in Iowa.
Yeah.
But it's always beautiful at the Rock Bowl.
Oh, yeah. Never a bad time.
Talmadge just kicks away, and it's a low one as it goes out of bounds, and that'll be a penalty. So we're seeing some kicking troubles on the kickoff for both teams here.
Yeah. Co had a kick go out of bounds, and they missed an extra point. Mm-hmm. Talmadge is not happy with himself walking to the sideline.
Failed to mention earlier in the broadcast, the Duhawks are on a 4-3, excuse me. So just flipped on defensive size, the 4-3 as compared to the 3-4. Motion here for the Cohawks. It's a handoff to Barnes, who was met in the backfield by, once again, Joey Foley.
Wow. Joey Foley playing like a linebacker today.
It was pretty good job by him as well, not bouncing off of Barnes after that first attempt, just hanging on to him.
Yeah, sticking with it, making him lose even more yards.
Ray Seidel was listed on our two deeps as a number one running back, but we have not seen him, so it kind of makes me feel like he is not playing.
Yeah, I have to assume he's probably injured.
As Maskey and Barnes in the backfield, once again, shotgun formation. They fake the handoff, looking to throw it, and miscommunication on both the receiver and the quarterback as he was looking to connect with the senior Logan Wynn.
Yep, they brought Foley on the corner blitz there. Bauer picked him up. And this miscommunication overthrew him by a good 10 yards.
And you saw right away where Maskey wanted to go with that ball. He wasn't even looking at anybody else.
Yeah, if he saw the blitz coming, thought he had a window. The Duhawks were all over it.
We got a stoppage of play here.
Move the ball back a yard.
Third and 12 here for the Cohawks. Nothing going on this drive for them. So Duhawk defense looking to make a big play here. Maskey, a little bit of a low snap, nowhere to go, and Josh Kiefer is going to get the sack.
They brought the pressure once again. Kiefer up to 4.5 sacks this year, I believe. 11.5 tackles for the loss total.
And looks like...
See the replay here.
Something with Kiefer's hand as well, as you see the replay here.
Brought Foley again.
Duhawks had, I believe that's what they call a jailbreak when they bring a bunch of people. As you see Kiefer's hand there, it looks like his pinky or finger might have came out of its socket or dislocated. Did you see that?
Yeah, that did look not pleasant.
As he's getting some attention from the trainers, they're going to punt this one away for the second time. As McGovern back there to receive it, and it hits off his face mask as the Cohawks would have returned it for a touchdown, but you cannot return muff punts.
Wow. The momentum was just about to go onto the Duhawk side. The defense has to run back out there for the sudden change. You could feel the momentum changing, and that's just a killer.
And Chase Cruz, the punter for the Cohawks, and that one just nailed McGovern in the face, as you'll see on the replay here, EJ.
Yeah, right off the face mask. Lucky that you cannot return the muff punt, because that probably would have been six.
Surprised that McGovern maybe didn't go for a fair catch there with the Cohawks kind of starting to swarm around him.
Yeah. Two Hawks have not been a great first half team so far this year. Once again, another not great first half so far.
And the kick and punt returns have also been an issue this year.
Yeah, I believe three or four muffed punts this year.
As Sanders, a running back there for the Cohawks, picks up 3 yards. Bring up, looks like, 2nd and 7.
Wouldn't be surprised if the Duhawks continue to bring pressure. Worked very well last drive.
Mask and Sanders. Shotgun formation. Rolls out of the pocket, trying to throw on the run. That ball is incomplete.
Interesting that Harris has been out there for Kemp. Last two drives, maybe Kemp just needs a breather. Maybe Coach Bauer's sticking with what worked.
Mason Morris and Jace Gwynn were the two nearest defenders for the Duhawks. As Jordan and Doyle check back in for the Duhawks, as well as Dawson Charlie.
Oh, another D-line change.
The three that just came in or the three that are just going back out? 3rd and 6 or 5 here for the Cohawks. Bad snap as he's going to be down on that one as he had picked that one up on his knee. Once again, the Duhawk defense coming up big on 3rd down.
Plethora of Duhawks once again in the backfield. Man, Joey Foley just appears to be in the backfield every play. Coach Bauer dialing up the pressure.
Must have been watching your high school tapes.
Duhawk defense, great response here in the second quarter compared to the first.
I can't wait to get this working.
As you can hear people talking into the, to some mic. As the Duhawks are back to kick this one away, it's Cruz once again. McGovern lined up. He's not even going to field this one as it's going to bounce into the end zone, thankfully, for the Duhawks.
Yeah, good hustle there by Eckhart. Just couldn't get there.
Hopefully some momentum going here still for the Duhawks.
Yeah, Loris offense needs to respond here. Need to find themselves in the end zone here.
Duhawks with 3 running backs in the game. That would be Britt, Bausch, and Pritchett. McGovern, the receiver at the bottom of your screen right there, right in front of you. And Brown will be at the top of it as Bausch moved out in motion. Is he going to hand this one off to Pritchett, who has nowhere to run as he loses yards, as there's going to be a flag on the play.
Did look like it was towards the end, so I would not be surprised if it was on the Cohawks.
Well, there's been a lot of flags so far.
I lied.
Tyson Smith, the man who they're going to get for the hold there.
Good placement for Housingay. It's called for the hold there.
Same personnel once again for the Duhawks. And do you think the Duhawks would maybe run a triple option possibly with Ty and KP both back there?
I wouldn't be surprised.
As they hand this one off. Excuse me, they don't hand this one off.
Oh.
And that'll be Alex Atchison with his second sack of the game, excuse me, as I'll be right at the 1-yard line.
Yeah, barely avoided the safety right there. Atchison just putting on a clinic today.
Alex Hitchin has been everywhere as he wanted the safety for that one. Bringing up 2nd down in a country mile. I believe it's 2nd and 29.
Wow.
As now the Cohawks smell blood in the water as their crowd's starting to get into it. As they're going to throw this one, and that one is going to be batted down by number 12 for the Cohawks. Darius Saunders.
Nothing cooking there for the Loris offense.
3rd down for the Duhawks as Jaheim Haynes and Crawford check in. Your receivers are McGovern, Haynes, Brown, and Crawford. Bausch lined up behind England.
If I'm Cohen, bringing pressure once again.
How do you beat the pressure here, DJ? With the drag route or just a little...
Yeah, got to get it out quick. And they do, but dropped.
J. Jaheim Haynes not having himself the best of days today. Drops that pass.
Backed all the way up to their own end zone. They almost got after a couple punts today. Got to bring pressure once again. Got to be careful not to step out of bounds.
As Aiden Driscoll, the freshman, right on his own out-of-bounds marker here in the end zone. 2 seconds on the play clock. They get the snap off, and that punt was away, but there's a timeout. Loris calls their timeout here.
Didn't like what they saw there.
With 9:45 left to go in this half, bring up a 4th-and-30 punt.
Defensive battle here in the second quarter. Two of the better defenses in this conference.
It'll be pretty hard for the Duoc defense, though. They'll be put in a tough position after this punt, unless Driscoll's really able to flip the field position with a lucky bounce or something.
Co doing a great job stopping Loris' offense, the number one passer in conference and the number five rusher. Neither have able to get going today.
Yeah, and we kick from our angle, we have a great look at the where the Duhawk linemen meet, and you can see Ty and England in there talking to him, maybe trying to get him fired up and get some better blocking out.
Yeah. Coe has just been all over the football today.
It was like we said, Driscoll standing right by the back of his end zone as he gets the punt away quick. As that one's going, they're going to fair catch this one. That was Shepherdson, I believe.
Great punt right there. Had plenty of hang time, allowing his guys to get down the field and force the fair catch.
As the Cohawks caught that one right on the Duhawk 35-yard line, as X marks the spot.
Don't want any return on that punt right there, since they are already starting on the lower side of the field. See Zach Kemp's back in there at safety.
Duhawk defense has been on the field a lot today. As Mask is back out there. They hand this one off to Barnes, who gets a yard.
Nothing going there. Good stop right there by Loris defense. I believe is Kemp in there on the tackle. Dawson Charlie. And there's a flag.
A very late flag on the play.
12 men in the huddle. Oh.
So we're going to replay first downs. There's an illegal substitution, which will make 1st-and-10, 1st-and-15.
Back up Cohawk offense a little more.
The receivers in for Coe, number 4, the tight end Cooper Zeck, as well as Dominic Shepherdson and Zamari Bruce, with Barnes in the backfield. Barnes gets a snap. And
ball! Oh.
Not able to hold onto the ball on the read option.
Yeah, second time that he's not been able to handle the snap today.
As Hayful is in the backfield right away. As the Cohawks are going to take out a tight end and put in a Mel Sarich for the 2nd-and-15. Second down, they fake the handoff. Looks to get out of his hands early. That ball just a little to the left and out of the reach of his intended target, Sarich.
Good coverage right there by Duhawks, bringing the pressure once again. Had to get out quick. Just couldn't connect.
Third down here. Cohawks haven't been able to get their offense going at all after that last touchdown.
And what do you think the cause of that is?
Well, this Duloc defense has stepped up. They found the keys to bring some pressure. The Cohawks have not been able to stop this Duloc defense when they're bringing the blitz.
Let's see if they bring the blitz here on third and long as another play action. And the Duloc get through there, but unable to pick up the first down is Co. as they get past the original line of scrimmage. And this is a much shorter fourth down, as it looks like it's going to be a 4th and 6, and the Co offense is staying out there.
Yeah, definitely got to go for it here. Long field goal attempt, 4th and 5. Just try to get a little quick pass here.
Duloc trying to get this crowd into it here on this big 4th down. So you can kind of hear him getting into it. A big 4th down here early in this game as it looks like they're trying to get a screen to Shepherdson, and he's met in the backfield right away by the Duloc. I believe that was number 36, Josh Rydberg.
Yep, great play there by Rydberg, but Blaine Jordan is down on the field. He looks to be in quite a bit of pain. Great stop there. See the replay.
What was Coe thinking there going for a screen on 4th and 5?
Well, he had a lot of open space. If he could have just made Rydberg miss, he would have been easily pick it up, but he could not make a miss. Great sell job there by the Coe offense as the Duloc brought the pressure. And it looked to be a non-contact injury for Jordan there, so that's no good. Those are always very scary.
And he can't move his left leg either as he's hopping to the sideline.
Hopefully he's okay.
As they're trying to have him walk on it. Duloc with some momentum now. As Bausch and England in the backfield, Haynes motioned in the face of England. Looks Haynes' way, doesn't like what he sees, and he gets it over to McGovern underneath. As McGovern stays on his feet, still on his feet, keeping the legs going, rumbling, bumbling, stumbling for the first down.
Great pickup right there by McGovern. That's going to get the boys fired up. A little momentum going in their direction as it took all of Coe's defense to bring Marty McGovern down.
Marty looks a little tired after that one. We got a first down here.
See the replay right here.
As England gets the snap right now. Nice. Gets that one off, so I believe that was number one, Dwayne Emulis.
Nothing there. The Cohawks are all over it. Dwayne ran into a brick wall of two Cohawk defenders.
2nd and 9 here for the Duloc as they are now on the Co side of the field on their 49-yard line. Dwayne, Jaheim Haynes, Damani Brown and Michael Crawford, the receivers in the game, as Bausch motions out of the backfield. England steps up in the pocket, trying to make a man miss, and he does as he gets above the line of, gets past the line of scrimmage and picks up the first down, makes it a 3rd and manageable.
That was one of those no, yes type plays right there from England. Able to escape the defenders right there. Aitchison's not easy to get away from either. Great play right there.
Also kind of reminds you of Russell Wilson, able to stay up in the pocket with people coming around him. 3rd and 5 here for the Duloc. So they get the snap. England drops back, feels the pressure, and he's brought down by, I believe, there's a group sack there.
Yeah, it's great pressure right there. From number 33, Stone Cummins.
As the Duloc are going to bring out the punt team once again, as Driscoll hoping to pin the Cohawks back deep and help this Duloc win the field position battle.
Does appear that Housingay is out for the game as his pads are off and his helmet is off.
Punt here from Driscoll. Spiral. Gets a good bounce for the Duloc. That'll pin the Cohawks at the... It looks like that's the 18-yard line.
Great punt right there. A couple Duloc bounces.
Driscoll. Ball spotted at the 13-yard line.
Good job of flipping the field too. Coe hasn't been able to do much this quarter offensively. Try to get some better field position for the Duhok offense here.
And just how big of a role do punters play in games here? Because I know they don't get a lot of talk about, but they do play a key factor, correct, EJ?
Well, yeah, if the Duhok defense can keep them pinned back here, maybe you give the Duhok offense a much-needed boost to starting on the Coho side of the field.
As Maske rolls out and throws that one to Zamari Bruce for a gain.
Jace Quinn and Mason Morris right on top of that.
Second down here for Coe. Second down here. Because the marker on the field is wrong. It says third down. Same personnel out there for both teams. High snap. Mask recovered it no problem as there's going to be a loss on the play. I believe Josh Kiefer is back there once again, EJ.
Once again in the backfield for a tackle for a loss, I believe. Nope, just no gain.
Almost back to the original line of scrimmage here, bringing up third down.
Duhok defense has been sniffing out the run today.
Third and eight here for the Cohawks. I believe that was Barnes, the running back. They fake the handoff at Sanders, but excuse me, they're looking to take the top off, and they get him. That is Bruce. Once again, as the Cohawks take the top off the Duhawks.
He had a step. It's a great pitch and great catch right there by the Cohawk quarterback and receiver. Tight window he fitted into.
It was a good one-handed catch as well. Like you said, good window to fit it in and all that stuff. As the momentum is starting to get on the Coe side now.
We haven't seen Coe look deep down the field too much this game other than that play, so a good mix up there by the offense.
And both their touchdowns have come from those deep shots, so kind of surprising that they haven't really done it more.
Yeah.
As Coe's going to hand this one off to Sanders, who makes a couple guys miss behind the line of scrimmage, but still loses half a yard to a yard.
Neither ground game able to get going so far. Both teams rushing for over 150 yards a game this year.
Second and 10 here for Coe. So trying to drive the Duhawks offside with the hard count. 10 seconds on the play clock. Play clock's now down to 5 seconds here as Coe's going to get this one off fairly quickly. Another high snap as they hand this one off to Saunders, who's met right away by number 97, Eli Dirks.
Dirks, the strongest man this side of the Mississippi.
Mm-hmm. He's a big fella, a power lifter, and one of those guys that can make those arm tackles just because of his pure strength.
Yeah. Tough assignment for any offensive lineman to block.
Third and 10 as there's a flag thrown and probably a false start. Yep. Number 7 false start on Zamari Bruce, the freshman who caught that long touch. That long catch there earlier in the drive. Mask in the backfield with Sanders. They're making an adjustment here with 7 seconds on the play clock. Down to 4. Get the snap off with 3. As they're looking to throw it deep, going Jace Gwynn's way.
Wow.
He high points the ball. Bruce high pointing that ball over Jace Gwynn. And that freshman has been a problem for the Duhawks this drive.
Yeah, that was good coverage there by Jace. Couldn't make a play on the ball. Great play right there by the freshman, number 7. Zamari Bruce.
He's been eating the Duhawks alive this drive.
Yeah, it looked like it was going to be an interception for sure for Gwynn. Just Bruce went up and got it.
And Bruce is listed at 6'2", height-wise, and Jace Gwynn 5'10". How big of a factor do you think that played in that previous play?
That played everything out. Jace was just a little camp, a little too short right there. Jace does have quite the vertical, though.
As Coe is going to call a timeout.
Big first down conversion right there. Third and forever. Just throwing it up and your guy goes and makes a play. Coach Bauer cannot be happy.
As both teams looking to make some adjustments here, as Coe is in the red zone once again. I believe this is their first time we see a replay here of that long catch on that third down.
Yeah, it looked like Jace was playing more on the inside. Thought the ball was going to come on the inside. It was on the outside of the receiver.
Now you see Foley matched up with Bruce on the bottom of your screen.
7-on-7.
And Grit and Gwynn up top with Shepardson, but it doesn't matter as they hand the ball off to Sanders. Brett Bauer in there to make the tackle.
One of the few positive runs there for Coe. Still calling another timeout.
Coe calls their second timeout here with the minute 21 remaining in this first half.
Duhawks have had the opportunities in this game, just have not been able to capitalize. A couple mixed connections with England and Crawford. Big opportunity for an interception on 3rd and 15, just could not come up with it.
And I believe we have not seen Blaine Jordan in the game after he went out, but he's on the sidelines. He's talking to the athletic trainers. He appears to be moving okay. Second down here for Coe. To keep inching closer to the Duhawk end zone as Zek has moved in motion. They fake the handoff to Sanders. Maske pushed out of the pocket as he's hit hard by number 36 for the Duhawks, Josh Rydberg.
Great play right there by Robert Rydberg. Good hit to keep him in bounds. May Coe use their last timeout.
That's Coe's last time out here on third down. And if the Duhawks stop, then I have to imagine Coach H would call timeout.
Yeah,
right?
Absolutely. Try to get someone going deep down the field, the Brown or Crawford.
Because if Coe, you're already thinking you have a field goal here. It's not too long of a kick, and you'd assume that they would just, you know, not want to take a sack.
Yeah, probably try to kill some more clock. You got a minute 10. No need to be in a hurry. Honestly, kind of surprised they called that last time out there. Do you think they want to kill some more clock?
A minute 10 left here in this first half. Bring up another key third down. That's something the Cohawks have struggled with on third down. They haven't picked up a lot, and that's props to this Duhawk defense. So Coe's getting the communication back in with 12 on the play clock. As Coe's going for the end zone, and no good as Foley was the closest player on both teams to that ball.
Yeah, dangerous pass right there.
As Coe's going to bring out
the kicking team.
So there'll still be around the minute for the two Hawks to take over after this kick.
As the holder is Will Couch, the senior from Phoenix, Arizona. The long snapper, Stone Cummins. And the kicker, Julian Garcia Ayala. They're trying to make it loud for him.
Stone Cummins is a great name.
It is. It's a name for media. As Helminiak calls a timeout. Maybe he shouldn't have because he missed the kick.
Prior to the snap, timeout for second and a half.
Oh, there's a flag on the play, but the ref picked it up, so I don't know if Helminiak saw something or what. But if they come back to make that kick, you may look back at that timeout, EJ.
Yeah.
Because that kick was wide left.
Interesting. Now you also only have one timeout for the offense.
As this will, I believe, be marked as a 34-yard field goal. As the ball is part of that at the 17-yard line. And EJ, do most block kicks, do they come from up front, or is it usually from the side where those?
Yeah, usually coming off the edge. Usually coming off the edge. Look for Gwynn and Foley. Get some pressure coming.
Take two here for Coe on their kick. For Garcia Alele, as Helminiak is calling another timeout.
So no timeouts for the offense. Interesting choice.
So it looks like Helminiak just doesn't want this one. Maybe he's content with going into halftime down by 10.
Yeah, really wants.
Especially with Coe starting with the ball, that's kind of surprising.
Yeah. Trying to make the Coe kicker overthink this one.
Teams both coming back out there now for the kick. Garcia Alaya back to kick this one. 34-yarder. First attempt was wide left. His second attempt, I believe.
Wide
no
right.
Good once again. That's huge as Coach Greg Bowers fired up. The defense coordinator and special teams coach.
Missed both kicks.
And now you come back to those timeouts, CJ.
Yeah.
Do you assume that Coach Helminiak's just going to run this ball and run the clock out?
With a minute six, I think they'll probably take some shots down the field.
Look for Monty Brown because, you know, three things are certain in life, EJ. Death, taxes, and Monty Brown's always going to be open.
Yeah, Monty Brown coming up with the jump ball.
England and Jamal Britt, the two in the backfield. As Britt motions out to the flat. One-handed catch brings it in. Shockingly, does not go towards the sideline and makes a move back to the inside of the field.
Yeah, I think they wanted him to go out of bounds there.
As the clock is ticking here, bringing up second down.
Got to go fast.
A lot of walking around here from some of the Duhawk personnel on the field. England gets a snap again. Pushed up in the pocket. Throws it off to Britt on the sideline, out of the flat. Picks up the first down and wisely gets out of bounds.
37 seconds remain here for the Duhawk offense to get something going. Hopefully you can at least get in field goal range here.
Looks like the ball will be spotted at the Duhawks 33-yard line. Same personnel this whole drive. As Coe's playing a little soft, bringing four and throwing over the middle.
Oh,
that ball is... Get the official word from the official here.
Bounce around quite a bit.
Hit the ground as they're bringing everybody in here to talk about this one. I've just seen a lot today. It's a lot of group discussion from these officials.
And they're going to say that ball did not hit the ground. Let's take a replay and decide for ourselves.
Yeah, I don't think it hit the ground. Just took about seven bounces off the co-defenders.
As you see, England, there might have been a hold out there as well.
Definitely was a hold.
And you can't tell from that angle, but
yeah.
If it did hit the ground, it would have been when he first dove for it. It doesn't matter now as Co has the ball with 29 seconds left here. Maskey dropping back. Feels the pressure. Pushed up in the pocket. Looking deep. That's going to be no good, but they're going to throw a flag. As I believe that was Ryberg on coverage. Looks like he's hurt after that as well.
Awful turn of events here for the Duhawks. Interception, injury, that was also pass interference. He was able to step up and escape the pressure right there.
He's going to get some medical attention here. It looks like number 18, Tim Harrington, the defensive back, is going to go in for the Duhawks.
Luckily for the Duhawks, it is not a spot foul.
And that's the thing about college football. Pass interference is 15 yards. And meanwhile, in the NFL, it's the spot of the foul. As Coe is getting a little too excited, Ryberg's still not off the field. They want the play clock to restart there. They get it. Now we're able to play ball once again. Mask dropping back, looking out to his right in the flat to Shepherdson, who picks up the first down, gets out of bounds, stop the clock.
Wide open receiver, and now they are in field goal range.
In on the stop is Jace Flynn and Zach Kemp. First down for the Cardinals.
Mask and Sanders, your backfield. Mask, quick drop back, looking to get it out early in the flat to Bruce, and I'm going to say he caught that one. Even though he was bobbling it the whole time, I'm going to say he caught that as Brett Bauer was on coverage there.
That was a great catch to hang onto it despite taking that shove from Bauer right as he was meant to catch the ball. Incredible that he stayed in bounds as well.
And Brett Bauer is... It appears that's who they've really been targeting, this Quahog team.
Yep. Bruce has just been able to take advantage. He's taller and more athletic than these Loras defensive backs. And he's having himself a day.
Quahogs have already missed one extra kick, extra point, and a field goal. As that one is good.
Wow. So Loras gets the ball back with 1:06 left. Can't do anything with it, and Co comes right back down and scores.
Putting the Duhawks at a 17-point deficit here towards the end of this first half. As you see that previous touchdown pass.
Just an amazing catch right there from Bruce.
And I just know defensive coordinator Greg Bauer's not happy with how this defense has been playing so far.
No, he... He's not going to be happy with them at all.
Because all the touchdowns, for the most part, except for the rushing one, have been those deep balls.
Yeah, there's a few mistakes that have hurt Loras. Overall, they haven't looked too bad. Just a few huge plays have hurt them.
Harrison Willis and Ty Bausch back for the Duhawks. Stand right around the 10-yard line.
Another bad first half for this Duhawk team. Cannot continue to happen.
Both teams come into today, both with only one loss in conference. Co 3-1, and the Duhawks are 4-1 as they do a squib kick here. And Ty's going to let it bounce and pick it up. Ty looking to make something happen here at the end of the half. So he keeps those legs turning past the 30-yard line.
3.3 in the clock.
That'll be unnecessary roughness there on Coe on number 82 as he shoved a Duhok. That's Devon Kalash, the freshman, that just shoved a Duhok in at the end of the play.
After the play, on the kicking team, number 82.
A lot of discipline issues from Coe so far today. A lot of late hits and unnecessary roughness.
Yeah. Hasn't hurt them too bad, though.
That penalty will be enforced now. First down and goal.
So wouldn't be surprised if Loris was just going to knee it out, but after that penalty, they probably are going to take a shot here.
A little bit of a Hail Mary, throw it up to the end zone, or?
Yeah.
Because, with 3 seconds don't count. We can't even make a play out of bounds.
I don't know if England has the arm to get it all the way there, but maybe.
Might as well try it.
Yeah.
Or maybe try little tosses back and forth at the end.
A little schoolyard football.
Just going to hand this one off to Britt. Looks like they're just going to run this one out, literally. As at the end of the first half, Coe College 20, Duhawks 3. And some of the Duhawks just improve a little bit here on the defensive side of things. And now we're going to toss down to Adam Rodriguez for our sideline.
Thanks, guys. Just wanted to touch real quick on that targeting call that we saw late in the first quarter on number 49, Ben Rittenhour, for the Quahawks. You're going to see replay here of that targeting call. It was questionable. You could hear both fan bases chirping at one another, chirping at the refs about it. Down here, definitely looked like a targeting. Rittenhour kind of looked like he leaned with the helmet. But at the half right now, the refs will be going up to the booth to look at the replay. If it is, in fact, not targeting, he will be back in the game. If it is targeting, he will still be disqualified from the game today. Back to you guys.
Awesome. Thank you, Adam. And just like we suspected, the officials will be coming up here. But, EJ, what can both teams do to improve in the second half?
Both teams need to work on their discipline. Coe with the penalties and Duhawks with their coverage deep down the field. They have been burnt and burnt all over again. Burke is having himself a career day right now. Duhawk offense needs to get going. Nothing on the ground, nothing really in the passing game either. Coe's defense has done a great job of getting pressure and making plays.
Yeah, and we'll be back right after halftime. Stay tuned, folks. Should be a good one. All right, we are back at halftime, and right away we're going to toss down to Adam, who got some halftime information for us.
Second quarter, I mentioned that targeting call on Quahawk, Ben Rittenhour. Refs went up to the booth to look at the targeting call, see if it actually was. They went up, said there wasn't enough evidence to call it targeting, so he is now back in the game, and that targeting call was overturned. As for both teams, this Duhawks team looks very locked in for the second half. After a very demoralizing first half, wouldn't be surprised if we see a little more action out of the Duhawks and hopefully get a victory here for them. Back to you guys.
Awesome. Thank you, Adam, for another great report. Got that halftime information. We heard the officials discussing it, saying they couldn't quite see the helmet, even though it looked pretty clearly to us, EJ, at least.
Yep, get a call right here.
Which is a call that I personally don't think was correct to switch that, as it looked pretty clear that he led with the crown of his helmet.
Big reaction right there. Quahawk fans very loud walking back in from the tailgate as the Duhawk fans do the same.
But that is in the past. Now, as we're going to get into the second half where the Duhawks are going to have to score 17 points to tie this one up.
Yeah. First half, nothing was cooking really for the Loris offense. England was held to just 100 yards passing, as they had more than 150 more passing yards than we did, as they had 251 yards through the air, but only 19 yards on the ground.
And England was sacked twice that half, two from Stone Cummins and two from Alex Aitchison.
Cohen at 2 rushing yards. So, completely different co-offense than what they've been used to this year. Usually led on the ground with very few passing yards.
So we have a holder here for Scott's kick. This is a good one. Spin a little bit sideways as he mishandles the punt. He's at the 15-yard line now. Now at the 20 as he steps out of bounds. And another dropped kick. That is the second one we have seen, but luckily for the Co, they're able to recover it.
Yeah, that one was tough. That was a nice liner off the foot of Talmadge. Quiet to start the second half here for the Duhawks.
What are some adjustments that Coach Bauer probably tried to make in this halftime?
Well, I think he probably laid into his defensive backs, telling them they have to make a play. They've had a lot of wide open receivers and then a couple plays where they could have made up or went up and made a play on the ball, and they just did not.
So they hand this one off to Barnes, who fumbled it in the first quarter. It looked pretty good since.
He does have to be happy, though, probably with how his linebackers and his defensive line played the run and got after the quarterback so far today. Need to continue with the pressure.
As the Rock Bowl is awfully quiet at halftime. Like EJ said, both fan bases going to their tailgates, slowly making their way back in for the second half. Mask and Barnes in the backfield. As Mask mishandles the snap, looks to throw it over the middle, over the seam, and look at that. Shepherdson with the reception. Joey Foley on coverage.
Yep, the Cohawks continuing to cook. Great day here today for Carter Mask.
Like EJ said, Mask in that first half, 251 yards passing with 2 touchdowns, with a 59-yard pass being their longest, which is over double England's longest pass of the day, with 21. Mask drops back, looking to get it out quick. I believe that's Sarich with the reception near the first down marker.
Nice curl route there. Found the soft spot in the zone. Just shorted the first down marker.
And what kind of high energy play are the Ducks going to need to get everybody back into this game?
They're going to need a sack, a pass breakup, something. These DBs not look too good today.
This Coe's going to hand off to Barnes again, who gets a first down and a couple after that.
Already more yards this half on the ground than they had the first half.
Rushing attempt for Trenton Barnes. Tackle made by Andrew Hafel.
Hafel making the tackle.
I have to think a big reason Coe has struggled on the ground today is they're missing their leading rusher, most likely due to injury.
Mask gets the snap, hands off to Barnes again, who runs over his blocker and is brought down by the Duhawks defensive line.
Another rushing attempt for Barnes.
Hateful in the tackle again.
Second down.
Hafel and Kiefer both having good days so far. Hafel had the fumble recovery that was forced by Joey on the first drive of the game.
Second down here for Coe as they're on the Duhawk side of the field once again. Barnes and Mask in the backfield. Barnes cut that one back up the field. It'll bring up third down for Coe, and a big third down here early in the second half for the Duhawks.
Yep, Duhawks need to stop here. Most likely going to be a pass. See who's going to step up and make a play. Maybe send some pressure here.
Rushing attempt for Barnes. Tackle made by Elijah Gertz.
So you hear the crowd starting to get some chants going from the bleachers, willing this defense on third down. As Coe's going to fake the handoff, and the pressure makes him throw that one behind Sarich, who had a lot of green space in front of him.
Yeah, the pressure forced the throw to be behind. If it was on him, Jace maybe could have got a hand there, but it looked like they would have been able to pick up that first down, possibly a lot more.
I was unable to see who the pressure came from out of the cornerback slot, but it was a quick hitter for the blitz.
This punt team comes on here.
Cruz, who's also a cornerback for Co, will be punting this one away. So you hear people willing them to get that ball. It's a little bit of a punt here, and Ty's going to fake the fair catch. Is that ball a fairly good punt there from Cruz? Because that ball's going to be marked at the Duhawks' 5-yard line.
Number 14, Chase Cruz with the punt for Co College.
As the Duhawks' offense is going to have to go 95 yards here for a touchdown.
Great punt there for Co. Making sure it doesn't go in the end zone, but does pin, but do they do pin do or the Duhawks inside the 10.
England Bausch in the backfield. They hand this one off to Ty, who goes absolutely nowhere once again. And the first half woes look like they're showing already in the first play for the Duhawks of the half.
Nothing going so far for Ty on the ground.
Monty Brown, you see right there, number 5, the left of your screen, as well as Crawford and McGovern, the receivers. As England's going to throw out the back of his own end zone, looking for McGovern, deep down, and he caught it, but he's out of bounds.
Yeah, good catch there, just could not stay in bounds.
There's a great coverage there by number 14, Chase Cruz.
Already third down for this Duhawk offense. They were able to pick up one more first down in the first half than Co, but 100 less total yards of offense.
Let's see the play clock there. Is that 11? As they're just going to be content to hand this one off, but it looks like it's going to be marked down at the 1 with forward progress.
Man, when Co smells blood in the water, their defense does not give up at all. Second time, Duhawks have been pinned back on their own 1-yard line having to punt.
As Driscoll will be back out for another punt to start this half off for the Duhawks. Snap is away. Driscoll gets it off quick. Shepard's going to catch it at the 40. He's going to run backwards. Get knocked out of bounds by the Duhawks.
Good coverage right there by the Duhawk punt team. So Duhawk offense, or excuse me, defense right back out there asking to get another stop.
In the Duhawks' last game against Simpson, they put up 63 points. So the two games the Duhawks have won in the past 2 weeks, they put up 60 points both times. And as you can see here, Duhawks only have 3 after that first half. So a little bit of switch up of pace. Definitely some step up in competition is playing a factor in that as well.
Yeah, this is easily the second best defense the Duhawks have faced all year.
As Co runs out. He has man wide open as Jace Gwynn fell down, and Shepard's going to take that one into the end zone for the Cohawks.
Wow, yeah, Jace just fell down in coverage right there, led to the wide open receiver who easily got in the end zone.
Pushing it up to a 26-3 lead for Co. And if the Duhawks want to get back into this one, it's going to have to be quick.
Yeah, it's going to have to be right now. They're going to have to get something going on this drive. Can't keep asking the defense to go out there with no points put up by the offense.
Julian Garcia Ayala, once again to kick this. Made his last extra point, but he has missed one and a field goal. That one is up. Looks like it was right down the middle.
as it was. Giving Coe a 27-3 lead. As here's the replay that EJ's going to break down for us.
You see him roll out there. Jace tries to get up, can't get up fast enough. Just easily got in the end zone there. That's tough. Just another thing not going the Duhawks' way this game. Seems nothing has.
And like EJ said, nothing going the Duhawks' way this half. And when your punter has 5 punts in the first half, that's usually not a fairly good sign,
yeah,
EJ.
When the punter has more yards than everyone else.
Yeah. And both teams undisciplined. 6 penalties for Cohen, 5 for the Duhawks, with the Duhawks having 55 yards in penalties and Coe having a whopping 70 in that first half.
Both teams will look to clean it up. Yeah, a lot of Coe's penalties coming after the play, too.
That's a good kick for Coe as Ty has to run backwards to catch it. He's at the 10-yard line. That's all he's going to get as he gets to the 15.
Great tackle right there. I believe it was number 7, Muhammad Akker. Just a streaking down the sideline like a heat-seeking missile coming straight for Ty.
Brings up a huge drive here for the Duhawks as they hope to put a touchdown on the board and get it back to within 17. Jamal Britt, the running back, as he motions out to the flat. England, nowhere to go. Steps up in the pocket. Looks like he's going to run for it. Gets a little past the first down marker as there's a flag on the play.
I think it might be a block in the back.
There is a flag on the play. There is no foul for an eligible downfield.
Oh, they thought when the lineman got downfield, they took the flag up.
Does that happen because the official thinks they're going to pass the ball there in the scramble situation?
Yeah.
Britt and England backfield are going to hand this one off to JB, who, just like his teammates, hasn't had anywhere to run today.
The brightest spot so far in this game has been the Coe defensive line and linebackers putting on a clinic of how to stop the run and get after the quarterback.
And they're really not bringing any extra people in on the run plays or their protections. They're just beating the Duhawks.
Yeah, not too many blitzes from this Cohawk defense. Just man-on-man beating the Duhawks.
England on 3rd and 10. He's going to look to pick them all up, and he just hits the check down to Jamal Britt for a gain of around 6 yards. Which will bring up 4th down and inevitably a punt. At the 21.
Driscoll's leg might fall off. Yeah. All the punts he's had to
probably had to get
today.
A halftime leg massage there to loosen it, yeah, up. A lot of heads down here as the Duhawks walk back to the sideline. So Duhawks moving around on the punt as well as Coe. Driscoll gets the snap, and he gets it away. So he's going to flip the field position as Shepherdson is going to catch that on his own 45-yard line.
I think Coe's going to continue to try to establish the run here. It has not worked so far this half. A little better than it did in the first half. I imagine with a 24-point lead, they're going to try to chew some clock, control the ball, and win the time of possession battle that they did not win in the first half.
Coe maybe not winning the time of possession battle because they had those
big deep pass.
Yeah, they, did, close to the they didn't need to.
So double running back look here for Co. As it's a read option, he's going to give it to Sanders, I believe. Oh, excuse me. Looks like they brought the receiver in. Number 82, Devon Kolash for that one as he checks right out.
Number 82, Devon Kolash. Tackle made by Josh Rydberg. Second down at the 47.
Second down here for Co. Second and eight. Sanders, the halfback in the game, is on the left side of Mask. Mask gets the snap. Fakes one throw. Looks like he's going to go deep. That pass is incomplete. Looking for Saric, who has Mike Brown on the coverage.
Surprised he didn't go to the other receiver. He had a nice double move there. Was hit right at the point of contact, but after that, it looked like there's nothing between him and the end zone.
So bring up third and eight for Co. And they've been struggling on third downs today. In the first half, they're just 2 of 7. They're 2 of 8 now after not picking up that third down earlier in the start of the half.
Both teams struggling on third down. Loris was 1 of 8 in the first half. Now 1 of 10.
Mm-hmm. And both teams are 0 for 1 as well on fourth down. As Mass is going to keep it. And Mikey Barber is going to greet him at the line and not allow him to go anywhere else.
And nothing working there for Co. I do like the read options they're running. Trying to make this Loris team, who's shown some Loris defense, who's shown some lack of discipline, make an undisciplined play.
That previous read option actually put the Cohawks behind the original line of scrimmage, which will make this punt coming on fourth down and 11. Looks like it's Ty back deep to return for the Duhawks, standing on his own 25-yard line. It's a laser punt away. Ty's going to let this one bounce out of bounds. Another good punt there by Cruz for the Cohawks.
Cruz has had himself a day so far.
Yeah, he is. The Duhawks are going to take over at the 13-yard line.
Out of bounds at the 13-yard line. First down for Loris.
McGovern, Crawford, Brown, three receivers bunched just outside of your screen. England and Bausch in the backfield once again. He's going to hand this one off to Ty, who's going to go nowhere just like he has all day.
This game looks a lot like the Warburg game. At least offensively for the Duhawks. Their offensive line getting beat up, not being able to run the ball, and constant pressure on the quarterback when they do pass the ball.
This is England. Three-step drop. Gets it over to McGovern, who ran a little bit of a drag route there. And is brought down by three co-defenders.
I don't think you can bring Marty down with one tackler.
Third down. Brings up another third down for the Duhawks. Looks like third and four.
Duhawks need to pick this up here.
A big third down. England gets the ball, 13 on the play clock. It's a QB keeper on the read option. He's going to stay on his feet for the first down as he takes that ball out to the Duhawks 35-yard line on the third down.
Great play call right there by Coach Olson. Nice read option. England picks it up with his legs.
And that's something I'm surprised the Duhawks haven't used more often, design-wise, is England to run out of the pocket. Not run out of pocket, just design run. England hands this one off to Ty once again. Ty looking to bounce it outside in. It's been a battle for Ty all game just to pick up 3 yards.
Yeah, that's one of the better runs he's had so far today.
So Duhawks got a little bit of a no huddle here.
England, another drop back. Forrest out of the pocket to his right. He's going to keep it as he runs out of bounds after a short gain here.
Loris's best offense has come from England's legs so far today. Another first down.
It was a first down, actually. I thought they spotted him a little short from up here. England gets the snap, looking over the middle to, I believe that's Crawford, who makes the catch on the slant route.
Pass is complete to number 81, Michael Crawford.
Nothing really working down the field so far for the Dewhawks. Everything's been pretty short.
Second down here in the Dewhawks. This is the best they've looked almost all game, moving the ball with ease. I believe that's Kaysen, who's the back in the game now, bouncing out to left side, as that'll probably be a hold call on the Dewhawks as a flag is thrown. Kaysen's second rushing attempt of the game. He had one earlier for 9 yards. As we're going to get the call from our official.
Personal foul on the defense, number 9, face mask. 15-yard penalty from the end of the run.
Another penalty on the Cohawks.
Another personal foul penalty, which is what we've heard basically come out of that official's mouth all
over
game
and over.
Over the speakers. Maybe give the Dewhawks a little bit of life here.
Yep, Big
and
Sean
Big
is
Sean
puking.
Just oof. Threw up on the field, and believe he'll have to come out of the game for that one, maybe.
Maybe I don't
not.
Think so.
Maybe not, no.
Yeah. I think they just blew the whistle because the ref happened to see it happen.
Yeah. He just threw up again, too.
That was That was an embodiment of Dolores' offense so far today.
You are not wrong, but I don't know if they're going to have some. They might have somebody come up here to get the vomit.
Yeah, there was a lot. There was a lot. You know, usually, I remember one time in practice, my freshman year, one of the backup centers puked right next to the ball and then snapped it.
Oh.
And then had a great pass set right there. So that's just part of being a lineman, part of being gritty, playing through the puke.
As the not so fun parts of being an athletic trainer are about to be shown right here. As you see the crowd there getting on the big screen waving, yeah.
Yeah, Dewhawk fans, stand up. There's not too much enthusiasm from the stands.
As that is Hafel's family right there to the left. They're holding up the 43. Pretty good crowd here at the Rock Bowl today. Dewhawk faithful always showing out.
It's a sharp Loris jersey.
It is. Looks like a vintage baseball.
Yeah, I need to get one of those.
Back to the action now as the puke has been cleaned up off the field. And the Dewhawks have a first down.
That's tough. Especially when Loris had a little momentum and drive was going. See if they can continue to pick up where they left off.
England in the backfield is going to hand off to Kaysen. Has to bounce it back outside after Connor Durdant just got blown up.
Yeah, the center. Great job by their nose guard right there. Instant pressure in the backfield.
As Renninger comes out for Jamal Britt.
It's a good cut right there by Kaysen to even get back to the line of scrimmage.
Second and 10 here for the Dewhawks. They're just outside the red zone. England, look to his right, look back to his left. I believe that's Crawford with the catch.
Yeah, a lot of targets today from Crawford. Always good to see.
So Third and very short here for the Duhawks. I'd assume it'd be a run here, but that'd be pretty dangerous with how the line's been blocking. And right on cue, Kaysen does not make it back to the line of scrimmage. Kaysen actually loses a yard on the play, bringing up fourth and two. And it looks like Coach H is going to stay on the field because field goal does you no good at this point.
Yeah, you got to go for it here. Would not be surprised if they get the ball in Damani Brown's hands.
Damani Brown, number five, bottom of your screen. Next to him, Jaheim Haynes. And at the top is that dude, Michael Crawford. England looking to the right to Jamal Britt, who is past the sticks for the first down. Jamal picking up the first down there. Give the Duhawks new life as they enter the red zone.
Need to keep this going. Down by 24. Need to go quick here in the last minute in fourth quarter.
McGovern checked in for Jaheim Haynes. Other than that, everybody else is the same as Bausch motions out wide. England gets the snap. He's looking for Crawford over the middle. And Crawford's going to get the touchdown for the Duhawks.
Hugh, do you remember what I recalled before the game? And
I do.
Early
remember.
On, I said Crawford is getting in the end zone.
That's a tight seam that England fit that ball into as well. And great concentration by Crawford catching that between two guys.
Crawford is Irish, but he still likes a little bit of England.
Talmadge going to kick this one away with England being the holder and Owen Patton the long snapper. Kick is up and it is good. Making it a 27-10 game with a minute 10 left in the third quarter.
All right. We're not out of this, boys. Let's keep it up. Let's get a stop and see the replay here. Crawford there at the top of your screen. It's not a little go route, found the hole in the defense.
Cruz was the cornerback that was closest to McGovern there, as well as number 30 for Co. Jack Shaw, the senior from Atkins, Iowa.
Good to see 81 get in the end zone for the first time this year.
His senior year as well. As out comes the Duhawk kicking team.
Surprise onside right here. Definitely not.
That would really be something.
Yeah.
As Scott boots this one away, and it's going to go out of bounds once again.
Three kicks out of bounds so far this game. Two for the Duhawks, one for the Co-Hawks.
The ball will be placed at the 35 once again. The Duhawks really don't need to be giving Co any extra yards here. They haven't been able to move very much.
Need the defense to pin their ears back, get after the quarterback, stop the run. We're right back in this ballgame.
Mask in the backfield. Play clock's at 5. They hand it off to Sanders,
oh!
And he's met right away by, I believe that was that Rydberg again? That
number 36.
Yeah, that is Josh Rydberg.
Josh Rydberg. He's had himself a day so far today.
He came screaming off the edge untouched.
Oh, no, that was Brandon Phelps. Excuse me.
Sanders, the running back for the Co-Hawks. Mask out there, as well as Bruce and Shepherdson at receiver. It looks like Zeck is the tight end as they hand this one off to Sanders. Sifting through the traffic and gets past the original line of scrimmage for third down. Looks like it's going to be third and eight.
Good run there, but previous negative play. Makes him only barely be able to get back to the line of scrimmage.
Third down here as both teams are going to take this one into the fourth quarter. And after three quarters of play, Cohawks 27, your Loras College Duhawks 10. EJ, what does Loras need to do here in this fourth quarter?
Well, this is the biggest play of the game so far, coming in to start the fourth quarter. Third and about 8-7 for the Cohawks. This defense needs to get after the quarterback, stay disciplined, stay on their man, possibly double team number 7 because he has made multiple Loras defenders look silly.
Mm-hmm. And what does Coney do to maintain this lead?
Defensively, last drive, there was off drive for them. They just have stopped the run well even last drive. They just need to keep England contained and make sure they stick on the Loras receivers.
So we'll see how this plays out here as 15 minutes remain here in Dubuque, Iowa, on the College of Loras campus at the Rock Bowl. Like EJ said, third down here, and it's a big one. Mask in the backfield, fakes the handoff to Sanders. Looking to get on the flat, and that one will be incomplete as that was Harris on the defense.
Almost an interception. If it was a little bit of a better throw, yeah, it actually would have been an interception.
So it's one of the rare times you're happy with the throw into the into the turf pellets. Brings up fourth down, and after that muffed punt, we haven't seen McGovern back there for the Duhawks as Bausch is standing on his 30-yard line.
Would not be surprised if Loras sends all the guys after the punter here.
And against Buena Vista for homecoming, our Nebraska was, and Foley did have a blocked punt as they get that one off with Duhawks flying around him. And tie another muff punt for the Duhawks as Bausch cannot come down with it.
Wow, that is a killer. That punt hung in the air forever. Turn tie around right off the hands and into the arms of the Cohawks.
And at that point, EJ, when you're spinning around, why not just let that ball fall and bounce?
Yeah, he should have.
If it doesn't take a bounce your way.
Yeah.
As now the Duhawks are really in trouble here.
There's a great stop right there by the defense, and then you ask them to go right back out. It's definitely demoralizing for that defense.
In that first half, they're out there for 12 minutes, 47 seconds, but they've been out there quite a bit here in this third quarter with the offense not being able to move a whole bunch. As that ball, Brett Bauer drops the interception over the middle of the field.
Yeah, it looked like he had his body turned a little bit to avoid the hit. If he just would have stayed in there and absorbed the hit, he probably could have caught that ball. Tough angle to try to catch it. Turn to your side, though.
Would have been big for the Duhawks. So it brings up second down, and Coe is spotted right at the 20-yard line.
The Duhawks have not caught a break all game.
Second and 10. As the Duhawks send a little bit of a corner blitz, Shepherdson on the outside. He's got one man to beat. As Harris knocks him out of bounds, and there's a flag on the play. Looks like it'll be a hold on Bruce, I assume, out wide on the screen.
Yeah, I'm not sure what else it would be. Surprised the Cohawks are passing the ball the first two plays of this drive. The run hasn't worked too well, but it has been killing clock.
Holding on the offense, number 7. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Repeat second down.
As they're going to repeat second down after the hold call. And Ty Bausch is sitting over there on the sideline with his helmet on, maybe in his own head a little bit, as you hear the leaves blowing around the stadium.
beautiful fall day here in the Rock Bowl.
Especially with all the trees changing colors and everything around here. Mask in the backfield. Fakes the handoff once again. Another play action. Kiefer in on the pressure as Shepperson catches it and gets hit hard by Jace Gwynn. Right by the line of scrimmage.
Mask has known where to look for his receivers all day. Once again, finds a weak spot in the defense and able to complete the catch. Unlucky for them, the penalty backed him all the way up. So still third and long here.
Same personnel once again for the Cohawks. Cooper Zek and Slade Hirta, both tight ends out there, as well as Shepperson and Sharsh. They're going to call a timeout here, not being able to get the play in. And as I saw, 5 seconds on the play clock. They're first for the half. And this Duhok defense looked good in that previous quarter, so the adjustments at halftime definitely paid off.
Yeah, Coach Bauer knew what the Cohawks want to do and knows how to stop them.
As we look at some of the stats here.
Lors with 26 carries for 40 yards. Coe with 23 carries for 11 yards, but 318 yards through the air for the Cohawks compared to just 156 for the Duhawks.
And no sacks for either team that previous quarter. So quarterback's getting the ball out a little quicker. Won't say that maybe projection's been better, but they've been moving around a little bit more. As third down here for Cone, they're looking for the end zone on the corner route for Shepherdson. And there's, looks like both teams looking for a flag, but there are none as Harris was on coverage and he fell down. And Shepherdson was wide open. Which is the second time we've seen a cornerback fall for the Duhawks on a corner route by Shepherdson. So maybe a little bit of a push off, obviously, on the corner routes.
Would have really, for Coe, would have really liked to get in the end zone there, put this game away, but holding to the field goal, the Duhawks still have a chance.
Especially with the struggles that Coe's had kicking today. And this will be the longest one of the day for Coe. Be right around 37 yards. The crowd's starting to get into it. He pulled one left earlier from this side. It's a bad snap.
And go! Joey Foley!
Pick it up off the run! Snap! Joey Foley streaking down the sidelines. 20, 15, 10.
Let's go!
Touchdown!
Running alongside Jace Gwynn. What a play. You do not see that happen. Most of the time, they would just fall on the ball. What a great play by Joey to pick it up. Great athletic play.
Joey Foley, the senior leader of this defense, with the scoop and score touchdown, bringing some life in here to the Rock Bowl. As there's an injury on the field, though.
It is Sean Doyle
for the Duhawks.
Injury timeout. Wow, what a play. Duhawks are in this game. Both of my roommates finding the end zone today. It was funny, the other day they were just talking about how neither of them had gotten the end zone yet this year and how that needs to change.
Maybe they need you to say they're both going to score a touchdown before each game now.
Yeah. Joey Foley, 5 picks on the year, 2 blocked punts, forced fumble, and a touchdown. What a year for number 7.
Talmadge looking to make this a 10-point game here with this extra point. Kick is up and it is good.
Extra point.
Talmadge remaining good so far today as we see a replay here of EJ's roommate returning it to the end zone for a touchdown, and that's where it becomes a foot race in. Foley is just too quick to be caught.
Yeah, no one had a chance.
As you see him hit the high five right there.
Almost left him hanging.
As the crowd, as loudest I've heard them all day on this side of the field. started to get into it.
The fans are back in it. We have some momentum.
I was about to say momentum's on our side a little bit. Looks like we got a ball game on our hands still, EJ.
Not out of it yet.
Maybe wishing this energy was here a little bit earlier in the game. And just a bunch of what-ifs if they had this energy earlier.
Yeah. Hopefully, Loris can get another takeaway here. Imagine first down run would be almost a lock here for the Cohawks and probably even a second down run.
And something to look at here, every game that the Duhawks have lost, they've scored 26 points or under. So it's a key factor to watch here as it's a dropped kick here by Coe. And they're able to still bounce it outside. He's met the 15-yard line, and oh, baby, here come the Duhawks.
The Cohawks are starting to look a little nervous here.
And every game that Duhawks have won is something to keep out for. They've scored 38 points or more. So when it's a shootout, that's the Duhawks' best chance to win these games, it appears.
First down for Coe College.
First down for Coe is the Duhawk defense is already out there ready to take control of this game. As Sean Doyle's getting treated on the table over there on the Duhawk sideline. Crowd getting into it. His mask looks to his left in the flat. He's got Shepardson. It's been there all day. Look, that's Mikey Barber with the tackle.
Surprised they threw it, but hey, it's been working. Duhawks have not been able to stop Mass in the passing game so far today.
Ball spotted at the 24, second down.
And what kind of coverage are the Duhawks running that those out routes have been open pretty much all day?
Yeah, I think they've been running zone primarily. A lot of these blitzes.
Is that something that Coach Greg Bowers a big part of his defense is the zone blitz scheme?
Yeah, he would mix it up. He doesn't stick to any one thing necessarily. He's very good at changing to the opponent's offense. It's a nice stop there on the run by Phelps once again. All over the backfield.
And this Duhawk defense has literally been the only supplier of energy, it seems like, in the second half. Besides that touchdown pass that Crawford caught, it's been all the Duhawks defense here. Bringing up another big third down here.
Both teams been horrendous on third down this game. An opportunity right here for the Duhawks.
Third and three for Coe on their own side of the field at 22-yard line. Mass is going to throw it on third and short. Has to draw it down. He's got some grass outside. Got one man to beat the line, and he doesn't get there. The Duhawks level him just short of the line. Got some pumpkin spice in there with that hit.
great coverage right there by the Loris DBs. He was able to scramble, but good recognition there by the defense. The quarterback was scrambling, rallied to the football to keep him short.
Some good discipline there, too, by Mikey Barber, not running away from his designated zone. He's able to slow him down and allow the boom to be laid.
Cannot have another muff here.
As Ty is looking into the sun right now, holding his hand up, should be interesting to see how he plays this punt here from Cruz. As it's a low punt, and Ty is just going to let it bounce. As it's going to roll, get a good Cohawk roll. That's going to be down to 30-yard line.
Absolute liner right there. I thought I was going to hit one of the Cohawks in the back as they're running down the field.
The ball is down to the 30-yard line. That's where Loris will have it, first and 10.
Loris starting on their own 30-yard line. Plenty of time left here to still make this one a close one, 10:51. But it's going to have to be right now, right, EJ?
Yeah, got to go fast, got to go no huddle, get on the ball. Still down by two scores.
England, and looks like that's Killian Pritchett. In the backfield, KP. England dropping back. KP sticks in to block. England trying to make something happen. Danton jumps it off to a lineman who, yeah, can't do that. As England's a little slow to get up here. It's been a rough day for him back there.
I'm surprised good hands there by the lineman, though. Way to be aware.
Looks like that was number 67, Titus Mullen, I believe, on the catch.
Gotta love when the big men get involved.
But I think the refs are discussing maybe if the toss was behind him, will that matter? The toss was behind him? Because if it's behind him, it's a run.
Yeah.
And runman can, and lineman can run the ball.
There's no foul on the play.
Oh, yeah. Good call.
Yeah.
So it was ruled backwards.
So basically a sack is what we just took, though.
Big break for the Duhawks, though, not getting the penalty there.
Looks like it's going to be 2nd and 12 for the Duhawks on the 28-yard line. Crawford, Haynes, Brown, McGovern, the receivers in with Pritchett in the backfield. Pritchett motions out left. They're going to dump it over the underneath to McGovern, I believe. And interesting that you're going for an underneath pass when you need 12 yards to pick up, as there's a lineman down for the Duhawks. It looks like it's Titus Mullins, number 67, the sophomore, out of Brandon, Florida.
Yeah, those drag routes across right by the line of scrimmage have not worked too well for the Duhawks today. We have seen them run that play a lot this year, but the Quahawks have been all over it. You see those fans hoping for a Loris touchdown.
As it looks like the trainers are attending to the right leg of Titus. I can't quite see if it's the ankle or the knee from up here.
Tough day for injury-wise for the Duhawks as well. Give a quick update here. Some other scores around the conference today for football. Simpson is playing at Central, and they are currently losing. The 0-6 Simpson, 17-49. It's 4-2 Central. Other scores around the conference, we have Luther playing at UD. I believe Luther should be 1-5 this year. Yes, they are.
Two next upcoming opponents playing each other for UD's homecoming.
Trying to get it up.
Mullins is still on the ground as they're bringing the stretcher over to him.
University of Dubuque is up 21-7 at halftime against Luther. And BV takes on Nebraska Wesleyan at 4:30.
As both teams have taken a kneel here. And a hush has fallen over the Rock Bowl.
Tough break for the Duhawks. Already down one lineman, losing another. Hopefully Blaine Jordan's okay as well.
as Titus has now been sat up by the medical trainers, and they put a air cast on that right ankle of his already as he is assisted over to the stretcher.
See the Duloc offense going. Make sure he's okay.
It'll be a 3rd and 13 for the Duhawks.
Some other scores around the American Rivers Conference. Men's soccer, Wartburg leads Nebraska Wesleyan 1-0. Luther leads Central 1-0, and Loris takes on BV at 3:30. Volleyball, Simpson beat UD 3-1. Nebraska Wesleyan beat Luther 3-1. And Co. beat BV 3-2. And the Duhawks beat Central 3-0.
First win in conference for the Duhawks out there, I believe, as well.
Women's soccer, Loris beat BV 6-0. Women's soccer, just once again, a juggernaut in this conference. Central and Luther tied, and Wartburg beat Nebraska Wesleyan 5-0.
As Titus is now being stretched off of the field by the paramedics. Hopefully he's okay. As we stated earlier, he has an air cast already on that right ankle, leg, and foot of his. It's always scary when you see the air cast on there already.
Yeah, not a good sign for the Duhawks.
3rd and 13 for the Duhawks. A big one here. 5 out wide, 2 at the bottom, 3 at the top. England rolls out to his right. Gets it to McGovern, short of the 6. McGovern's able to pick up the first down for the Duhawks.
When in doubt, give it to McGovern. He's going to make a play.
It was a good job there by England staying poised, because I don't think that was a designed rollout.
Nope.
And finding McGovern.
It's going to be tough for the Loris linemen with two backups in going against this potent Quahog defensive line.
England dropping back. Push up in the pocket. Pressure by Aitchison, but England stays away from it as he runs out of bounds and does not get anything.
Yeah, good chop to swim move right there by Aitchison on the outside. England just stepped up because he felt the pressure coming.
And Aitchison's been wreaking havoc on the Duhawks all game long. Like we said, came in leading the team. Coming in today, I believe he had 5.5 sacks, and he already has 2 today, so he's already bumped that total up to 7.5. As England relayed the play to his team. Dyer going to see many runs from the Duhawks as they need 2 scores here. Aitchison once again pressuring England to the left. England just going to tuck it down and run. He's going to step out of bounds after a 3 to 4 yard gain. Bringing up 2nd and 6. Another
rushing attempt. Nothing going. Last 2 plays for the Duhawks. Good coverage and good pressure by Aitchison. Feels like we're saying his name every other pass.
Credit to him for that, but as well as maybe start double teaming him or have a chip block.
Yeah.
England gets the snap once again. Steps up in the pocket, finds Haynes over the middle. Goes right down by that first down marker, and that'll move the chains for a first down.
England always with great pocket awareness, stepping up, delivering a strike to Haynes for the first down.
Is pocket awareness, is that something you can coach, or is that something you just have?
It's something you just have, mainly. You can try to coach, trap them up a little bit, but you see quarterbacks, especially like Justin Fields, he doesn't have a great O-line, but also he's not helping them out with his pocket awareness.
England, another pass here. Good day. Oh, good time in the pocket. As that ball was just a little underthrown to Jaheim Haynes, who he had there if you would have put it on him.
Yeah, ample time to throw there. He was open, just a rare miss by England right there. Don't see that too often from him.
And we can maybe see those co-defenders getting a little tired with Duhawks not really allowing them to have any substitutions. It's England and Bausch in the backfield. Britt out there as well with Haynes, Brown, and McGovern are your receivers. England, quick drop back, getting out over to Monty Brown, who's wide open off of that out route. To bring up a third and very manageable for the Duhawks.
Yeah, I guess got to get third and manageable at very least.
So Duhawks are on coast side of the field once again. And this is four down territory, correct?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Cannot give Co the ball back without getting any points on the board. You can kick three here being down by 10, but you got to get way closer.
8 minutes left here in this fourth quarter. As that ball is tipped and Ty catches that ball, they're going to lose yards here, bringing up a much harder fourth down.
Probably should not have caught that pass right there, but in the heat of the moment, it's hard to make that decision.
Mm-hmm. As the Duhawks are back to the original line of
they
scrimmage,
are going to punt.
And that's going to bring up a punt. Maybe if Ty didn't catch that ball.
Yeah, I think they would go for it if it was fourth and short. But fourth and 10, offense kind of struggled.
Driscoll has enough time to get the punt away. Shepherdson's going to fair catch that one. He's going to take a Duhawk bounce over Shepherdson. They'll be down at the 9 or 10-yard line. And Duhawk defense going to have to step up once again in the second half.
Yep, going to have to sniff out the runs here. Hopefully force them to the third and long. Tackle them short of the sticks.
Coe's offense huddling up, hoping to start moving the chains a little bit more than they have in recent drives. Out comes the familiar back duo of players today as Mask at quarterback and Sanders at running back. So they hand this one off to Sanders. He's going nowhere, met immediately at the line.
If I'm the Cohawks, I'm thinking about a fake to the running back and quarterback pulling it and running out, because we haven't really seen that too much from this team. They might be dialed in to the running back here.
Rushing attempts on the last play. Bring up second and 10 here for Co. Stop was made by Elijah Dirtz. Eli Dirtz on the tackle on that previous play. Mask rolls out to his left. Is that ball is going to be
caught
by Co.
Or is it?
Looks like he got some disagreement here by the officials. And he's going to say, I believe incomplete will be the final ruling. She'll bring up third and 10, which is huge for the Duhawks.
Yeah, stops the clock too.
If anything, I thought the Duhawks would come away with the interception once I saw it bounce back.
Yeah.
Up.
Huge play right there. The clock stops and they get no yards. Third and long, they've struggled picking it up first on third downs all day.
So crowd's getting into it here. 10 seconds on the play clock for Co. They get the snap off with five. Looking to throw it deep to the sticks, and that's a first down for Co.
Great awareness right there by number 7, Bruce, keeping his feet in bounds and being just a yard past the marker to pick up the first down.
Chase Gwynn on the coverage there once again. I believe he's been covering Bruce all game, who after the third quarter had 96 yards receiving, and he's well over 100 after that one.
Yeah, great game so far for Bruce.
And Gwynn was playing a little bit more too far into the inside there.
Yeah, playing off.
Which allowed Bruce to have that first down. As they hand off to Sanders, He's going to lose yards on this play as that interior of the Duhawk defensive line has been playing well.
Coming into the day, Bruce only had 11 catches for 215 yards. So he's really boosted his numbers today.
As Loris is going to call their first time out here with 5 minutes and 35 seconds remaining in the game.
Last play was a rushing attempt for Jaron Sanders.
Not getting any points. Last drive really, really hurts the Duhawks here. Because you almost are going to 100% have to onside kick if you do end up in the end zone. Or kicking the field goal.
So you can hear the crowd starting to get into it. With some beats on the benches, on the stands, excuse me.
You need some rally caps on.
Yeah.
Let's get your rally caps on, folks.
Second and 11 or 12 here for Co. With 5 minutes and 35 seconds remaining in the ball game. Co's going to motion Shepherdson. High snap. Mask able to get it down to Sanders. Who's able to get by the original line of scrimmage. And another timeout here for Lois. That's their second one.
Co has had continued troubles with the snaps today. Something to watch as Co is in a big pressure situation here right now. Third and long once again.
In on the stop is Andrew Hafel and Brett Bauer.
Hafel and Bauer in to make the stop there for the Duhawks.
Got to keep an eye on Bruce here. It's been Mass favorite target so far today. Good to see Blaine Jordan is back on the field rushing the passer.
As you see Coach Helminiak and defensive coordinator Greg Bauer talking to their defense about this big third down here. And if it's a pass play, you got to knock it down, stop that clock, so you still have one timeout to play with.
Yep. Try to force them out of bounds or force an incompletion.
It is a pass here, designed rollout to the right, and Shepherdson catches it, but I believe he stepped out of bounds. Not seeing any sign from the officials. Stop the clock.
Is he short?
As the clock is, it'll bring up a fourth down here.
Gonna measure.
It's gonna be a fourth down. As of where the spot was, it's fourth down. Co is not happy about this as the punt team's got to come out. And looks like Coach H isn't going to use that last time out. And Shepherdson might want to watch it here as he's laying into the officials. And
yeah, don't want to get another penalty.
Yeah. As Coach Bauer just told his special teams players to watch the ball. Yeah. Don't want to give them that free first down. As the punt is away, they get that punt off, and Ty is back there to receive it. As he's just going to let that one bounce away.
Great punt right there for the Cohawks.
It'll be downed at the Duhawks' 23-yard line. And I don't know, Ty just kind of seems in his own head on the field out there a little
bit. Yeah, sun's right in his eyes. He already dropped one. Marty dropped one earlier. Probably did not want to take a chance right there, but ball did just keep on rolling deep into the Duhawks side of the field.
Duhawks more than likely going to have to go no huddle here with only one timeout, but if you score here, you're going to want to save that for defense. It's going to be England and Britt in the backfield together. England dropping back, pushed out of the pocket to his right.
Wow.
And he's brought down with a tackle from number 45, Jay Ossendorp.
Great shoelace tackle right there. Once again, the Cohawks bring a pressure, and the Duhawks cannot stop it.
Coe sends four. England met in the pocket as Monty Brown's going to catch that one just short of the original line of scrimmage as the clock keeps going.
Got to get something down the field here for sure.
Third down here as the Duhawks obviously are in four down territory. It's been the same personnel for both teams all drive long. As England looks to his left, steps up in the pocket, nowhere to go. He's brought down for another sack on third down by number, I believe that is 81, Mitch Helmkamp, the junior. Which brings up if this game is going to keep going or not, really. As Coach Helminiak's going to call a timeout, realizing the game is on the line.
Fourth and long. They don't get it here. That's pretty much the game, Hugh, unless there's a mishap with one of the snaps or a fumble.
Duhawks all out of timeouts now with 3:25 left in the game. You hear somebody, I believe, yelling at the officials.
Co-fans
are letting their feelings be heard on how they feel about Loras.
Yep.
Fourth down once again for the Duhawks. One for two on the day. England drops back. Britt picks up a blitzer, and that is very short of the first down marker.
Well short.
And Coe is going to take over as that'll wrap up the game. Basically, just got to run out this last 3 minutes and 17 seconds. Unless the defense can make a play, and they'll obviously be going for that strip ball, right, EJ?
Oh, yeah, got to go for the ball. Got to try to get a turnover. No timeouts for the Duhawks. Can't stop the clock.
First and 10 here. As Sanders is going to get the ball here. And it'll be a yard short. I mean, a gain of one, excuse me. Messed up. I'm trying to hear what they're, some Sanders chirping going on
yeah.
down there.
Tackle made by Elijah Dirks. No gain on the play. Second down.
Second and 9 here for the Cohawks. So we're going to wind this play clock all the way down here. 10 seconds and counting down on it. Mask going to hand it off to Sanders. Do you see the Duhawks in there trying to punch that ball out?
Another rushing attempt for Jaron Sanders. Tackled by Dawson Charlie at the 25-yard line. Third down.
Third down here for Coe. Can the Duhawk defense remain strong here and get a stop? And we've just hit the 2 minute mark here in this game. As Coe is going to have to try and pick up this first down. They snap it with 1 second to spare on the play clock as they hand it off to Sanders, which will bring up a fourth down here.
Yeah, Coe probably just go for it here, try to run out the clock. No point in kicking
another
the field goal.
For Sanders. The stop is made by number 42, Milo Collier. At the 21-yard line, fourth down.
Once again, Coe taking their time, getting this play in, letting that clock run as far as they can. A as I believe they're just going to take a timeout here after the clock's run down. And that is indeed what they do. So Coe calls a timeout with a minute 03 left in the game.
Tough game for the Duhawks. Had lots of opportunities, just cannot capitalize. Great performance by the Quahog defense, only allowing the one offensive touchdown to Crawford. So both teams are back out on the field.
And looks like Coe will go for it here as the offense has come back out on the field. Oh, if they had them offsides, they would have snapped it.
Most of the time you teach the offensive players to move too, so they have to call it.
Fourth down, we're going to go over the middle of the field. And that ball was caught for the first down, and now all we have is the pleasantries, just taking a knee and then this game.
That will be game.
First down for Coe.
After the Quahogs take a knee here.
And Coe will advance to 5-2 overall, 4-1 in conference, as the Duhawks will fall to 4-4 overall, and 4-2 in conference, with their last two games being conference games, like we said earlier. Next week it's at Luther, and then Senior Day, November 5th. Senior Day against UD in the Key City Clash.
That is the ball game.
You see both teams shaking hands after the Duhawks lose this game. The final will be Coe College 27, your Loras College Duhawks 17. EJ, what really just went wrong for the Duhawks this week?
Duhawks weren't able to establish a run, probably a little over 2 yards a carry on the ground, and neither were they in the passing game. The passing conference leader, Evan England, held to under 250 yards. Tough game for him. Blown coverage by the DBs, but a good second half response from the defense.
And is offensive line something that the Duhawks are going to need to maybe take a look at?
Yeah, hopefully the guys are back and healthy next week, or at least ready to go for UD. Maybe Luther didn't probably able to win if they had me and you at offensive line, but they'll definitely need them back for UD.
Next week, like we said, the 29th at 1 o'clock, Loras is going to play in Decorah, Iowa at Luther College, and then come back on November 5th. As the Duhawks take on the University of Dubuque in the big rivalry matchup to end the season. Signing off for EJ Greenberg, I'm Hugh Maloney. Have a great day, everybody. Stay safe.
Peace.